If you've ever used ArcGIS or QGIS, you already know what it feels like to work with layers, attributes, and geometries. But what if you could do all of that and more using Python? That's what GeoPandas does. It's the open source library that brings GIS to the Python data science ecosystem. It can run spatial joins, buffers, intersections, just like in desktop GIS, but with code that scales, automates, and integrates directly with data analysis and machine learning workflows. Today, we'll look at what GeoPandas is, why it matters when to use it and not to use it, and how it's become one of the most important tools for modern GIS. So let's start with what GeoPandas is. So first of all, GeoPandas extends Pandas, which is a popular Python library for doing data analysis, and it adds supports for geometry types. Now, Pandas allows you to read in different file types, things like CSV, or TXT files, and turn them into what's known as a data frame. It's a temporary data structure in Python that allows you to do different operations on it. So you can do some summaries, you can get information about the different cells, you can group them and do all these different things, combine them, stuff like that. It basically is kind of like a virtual table inside of the Python ecosystem. GeoPandas allows you to do the same thing with many geospatial file types, specifically vectored files, and then read them in as a geometry alongside your other tabular data. It allows you to do different things. You can do some very basic plotting. You can put some things on a map. You can also do some basic spatial operations, things like spatial joins, just as a Pandas data frame can do a text-based or a string-based join. You can do a join based on the geometry or the features in that data set. So the easiest way to think about it is both the ability to read in files and turn them into geo data frames, as well as some basic operations that allow you to manipulate and analyze that data. Now, it uses some different libraries under the hood, uses Shapely for geometry operations that allows you to read in the shapes or the geometries specifically from vector data. Again, GeoPandas does not support raster data, so that's important to know. And you can use Fiona for file input and output, which of course uses GDAL under the hood. I have a whole video about GDAL here if you want to check that out. And then it uses PyProj for handling coordinate transformation. So it's kind of has all these pieces under the hood. Increasingly, it started to integrate with more of the modern geospatial data stack. It's using things like GeoArrow as a ability to read in different files and translate them between systems. It's added really good support for GeoParquet out of the box. So it's adding more modern tools all of the time. So in the simplest terms, when you boil it down, it allows you to treat spatial data as data frames with geometry columns. Much like PostGIS is the extension for, you know, Postgres as a database, GeoPandas is the extension for Pandas. It's kind of like where GIS meets data science, and it's all happening within Python. So that's the easiest way to think about what GeoPandas can do. So why should you care about GeoPandas? Well, it's Python native geospatial or GIS. It works with geospatial data the same way you would work with a CSV or an API or even machine learning data sets, right? It all does this in a Pythonic interface. So if you're coming from a Python ecosystem and need to add spatial capabilities, this is like your easiest step to go in and do that. If you're coming from a GIS background and wanting into Python, here's a very easy way to do that as well. It's gotten very popular because of those two different workflows. Now, interoperability is also key as well. It allows you to read and write data, things like shapefiles, GeoJSONs, GeoParquet. You can even connect into databases like PostGIS or read data from DuckDB and pull that in as a geo data frame. It also connects into systems like Apache Sedona and Sedona DB. So basically, it has this very easy way to work with all of these different file types, as well as these different systems. So it has this ability to work across lots of different things. Now, for automation, it's good for some batch analysis, not all scales. If you need a distributed system, that's something different, but it allows you to do quite a bit even on your local computer. It's increasingly gotten faster and faster over the years, which is great, and is really good for scripting. If you need to like script out a process or do these different things, it's good for that. It allows you to do reproducible workflows as well. Once you've written that script, you can run it over and over and ensure that it's going to run really easily. Now, one of the most important things is that it allows you to bring a data frame, which is a commonly used feature in machine learning workflows, into things like scikit-learn, even into tools like PyTorch or TensorFlow, or tools like XGBoost. It allows you to basically build spatial features in tabular data and then move them into some of these systems. Now, you can do that in other systems as well. Sometimes if you need to scale up or have more spatial processing, you can use a single node service like DuckDB or SedonaDB, especially if you need more processing. We'll talk about limits in a minute. And then if you need to actually do that at full scale, you can use different systems like, you know, distributed systems like Apache Sedona with Spark and stuff like that. So it's not to say that it's the perfect system, but it's one of the easiest ways to get started because Pandas is so commonly used in many data science and AI machine learning workflows. And finally, it's a really good bridge from GIS to the modern stack. So many data scientists are already using Pandas, and it can really help traditional GIS users use like spatial programming while getting something that still feels really familiar. So do you need it? And I rate this on four different scales. The first is personal projects, then one-off projects, small teams, and then enterprises. So for personal projects, like absolutely, it's a 5. Like it is a really easy way to get started. If you're using Python, that's where you're running it going with. And it is really easy. It's reproducible. Anyone can install it. So if you're building a project, you want to share it with people, they can install the same code that you're running. It's a really great way to do that. And for someone who is working in a Python ecosystem, it's very easy to explain your spatial thinking, gives you a clean script about how that goes from end to end, allows you to do some very quick data exploration and visualization. So it has a lot of these pieces filled in, plus it integrates with the complete Python ecosystem. So for personal projects, I definitely give it like a 5. It's a really great way to get started. It's a single install, and if you're using Python, it's a great way to get started. Now for one-off projects, again, same sort of value proposition that I would recommend for the personal projects. It's perfect for analysis that would otherwise require like heavy manual work in a desktop GIS. It gets that one single script, it's interoperable, you can share it in a notebook. Very easy to do, so once again, for one-off projects, a 5, probably even more than personal projects. Now for small teams, this is good. You have to consider your ecosystem, and this is where systems thinking starts to come into play. It's still very good for small teams, but where is your data living? If you're in a small team, you're probably not using just like files you're downloading or anything like that. So you need to connect it in. If you're doing work in Python, it's very good for data scientists, but that backend piece is where that data is coming from in different places. That's something you want to consider. And again, these are temporary data structures. So if you need to save your work, you have to have the ability to write it back to different locations. But for that specific kind of scripting, you know, development process, things like that, that you're doing exploratory work, it's still really powerful and so many different teams use it. So I recommend it as like a 4 for small teams, but you have to have other systems around it to really make it work really well. And that's, you know, a big component about how this fits in with all the other tools I mentioned before. Now for enterprises, that problem's just magnified a little bit more. I have seen people use GeoPandas in like production pipelines, but again, if you're pulling data into temporary data structures, you probably are pulling it from somewhere else and writing it to different places. That's where things can get a little fragile there, and you want to consider other systems as well. It can work, I'm not to say, but if, you know, for some reason that it gets to be too much data for GeoPandas, it takes too long, it fails, that's where you want to consider like distributed systems and different pipelines. If it's purely like I'm pulling data to do exploratory data work and, you know, data science workflows, again, you want the system around that, maybe a database for transactional data in PostGIS, maybe you want distributed processing with Apache Sedona, maybe you want, you know, ensuring you have cloud native formats in a data lake or a data lake house or things like Iceberg. All these tools fit into GeoPandas, so like I said, that interoperability makes it really foundational, and I would still give it like a 4 here. You just need to make sure you have all these systems around it. And probably most importantly, it makes it very easy for people from other teams that are used to working in Pandas just to get started and going. So it's still very, you know, powerful and an impactful tool, which is why I'm giving it a 4. But again, there's more systems and stuff around it, especially when you get to these higher levels. So how do you actually use it? Well, it's very simple to get started. You can just install it with Python. You can do a pip install GeoPandas. There are some times where you need other libraries if you're installing it in like a, you know, a virtual environment or things like that. But generally, in most all cases, just pip install GeoPandas and you're ready to go. Now you can load it. You can basically create what's known as a geo data frame. You can read a file in and it will create a geo data frame. There's two different structures of data types in GeoPandas. If you're really interested in GeoPandas, I have like a full course here that you can check out on YouTube and go through that. So check out that video up here. But basically you're reading in either a geo data frame, which is the geography piece or the geometry plus all the other data that goes with it. The geo series is just that single like column of data, and that's known basically as a list in Python, but it's a list of geometries. And that it, basically you're doing all your spatial operations on that single geometry column, not the entirety of the geo data frame. Now you want to be able to have some understanding of the Pandas ecosystem if you're using that. So that's something to keep in mind. If you want to use AI to get up and running and learning, you know, AI knows a lot of stuff about the, you know, Pandas ecosystem and stuff like that. So it can help you clear some of those hurdles. But basically, Now you can do some different operations on that GeoSeries, that geometry data. You can do things like buffers, you can do transformations, you can do spatial joins to other data frames and stuff like that. Again, keep in mind that these are all temporary data structures. If you need to save these out, you need to write them either to files, just like you would in a desktop GIS, or you need to save them back to a database or other system. But you can see there's a lot of functions that GeoPandas supports. It's not like fully featured. And again, this is only on vector data. You can't do raster data, but there's a lot of things that you can do here just to very quickly do some lightweight geo processing, or, you know, explore your data and do some different things there. It also integrates with a lot of other Python libraries. So it integrates with things like PySal and, you know, all those machine learning libraries, or anything that works with Pandas, it will work well with as well. So that's something to keep in mind. And you can combine it with, you know, different systems like DuckDB, Sedona DB. You can use PostGIS to read in data or write data back out to it, and GeoParquet as a, you know, kind of like a lightweight data lake to work for larger scale workflows. And they have some like very basic visualization stuff built in. You can use the dot plot function to actually do like a static map, or it added this like explore feature that allows you to create a very, very simple, you know, interactive map here. But it integrates with things like Folium, Matplotlib. You can use Kepler GL. So there's lots of tools you can combine it with to do some very basic visualization as well. But again, it's a, you know, data library. It's not a visualization library. So what are some of the pitfalls that you want to watch out for when using GeoPandas? Well, performance on large data is probably the biggest one. It's still going to be faster oftentimes than doing it with like just, you know, like a QGIS or something like that, but it's single threaded, right? It's not ideal for like millions and millions of features. It can handle a certain volume, but at a certain point it starts to slow down. So there's like your return on investment is a little bit tricky. There are some extensions like Dask GeoPandas. I haven't used that. Generally what I would do is I would just jump into Sedona DB or DuckDB. And if you really need more scale, you can use Apache Sedona with Spark. So there's like other alternatives that make sense there. So, you know, if you need to go to more scale, you can use that. And those systems, again, are all interoperable with GeoPandas, so like it makes it very easy to fit into that ecosystem. Again, it's memory bound, so it loads the entire data set into memory. It's not designed for streaming or distributed computing, right? You know, what I mean by that is if I have that file, it's going to load that whole file into memory. If that file is really big, it's a lot of memory to be using, so that's something to be aware of. Now, some of these other cloud native systems will just stream that over the query engine. And that's why I specifically recommend things like Sedona DB, which is built for spatial processing, or DuckDB, which has spatial features plus lots of other data features as well, where it reads it from a, you know, a remote source, or things like GeoParquet specifically, over the web. And the query is actually processing on the data, the source data. It's not actually pulling that data into memory. That's where when I say memory bound, it has to load all that data into memory. So it's something to be, you know, aware of when you're doing that. Another thing that's kind of tricky, especially for new users, if you're coming to this from a data science background, is just understanding projections. You know, like CRS is really difficult, or coordinate reference system can trip up new users. That's like, you know, anything in geospatial, just be aware of that. Always check your CRS or your projection using the .crs function to see. And in your doing spatial processing between two data sets, those have to match. And again, I mentioned visualization limits. It's not a visualization library. Plot is a basic function. Explore is a basic function. You probably need extra libraries to do that. One I would check out is LeafMap, which has like a fully featured kind of like interactive, you know, notebook type of feature here that you can bring in. So when should you not use GeoPandas? So for really massive data sets, that depends. Like massive is sort of a relative thing, but that's like large number of rows, complex geometries. That's where you want to look at something like using Apache Spark plus, you know, Apache Sedona, or Whereabouts in a distributed computing setting, or even like a single node service just to speed that up. You can use Sedona DB if it's heavy geoprocessing. You can use DuckDB if it's more like non-spatial processing and maybe some lightweight spatial stuff. So that's what you can use there to do that and read that in. You can also like read in data from other sources if you wanted to like push that in a data warehouse. I talk a little bit about like data warehouses and when to use them in this video. And if you want to look a little bit more about Apache Sedona, you can check out this video as well. So that kind of gives you an inference of like the distributed computing space. But again, interoperable, you can bring those things into GeoPandas and temporary data views and stuff like that. It is definitely not for like real time or web mapping. You want to use it like, you know, some different tools for that. You could use PM tiles for creating tiles. You could create, you know, sort of like a tile based backend, all these different things, but it's not for real time mapping. It's a data tool at the core. So that's really what it does. And probably one of the biggest things I mentioned is that this works with vector geometry data. It's not for heavy raster processing. There are ways to pair it with things like Rasteria or X-Array. So you can bring those together, but if you need to do a lot of stuff with raster and vector data in the same system, I would check out Apache Sedona, SedonaDB, or PostGIS are only the real systems that do that in one single place. And again, if your workflow is like totally driven by the user interface, you may still wanna be using ArcGIS or QGIS. They may be still more efficient for specifically visual editing. If you're editing and manipulating geometries, this is a data-driven system. It is not for like editing geometries or like that type, that side of geoprocessing. You kind of want to stay in a desktop system if you're doing that. So where can you use more? You can definitely check out the GeoPandas documentation. It's really well written. It gives you a lot of information there. I would also check out I have this full tutorial on GeoPandas here that'll walk you through. You'll end up with like a portfolio project, so you can check that out. Professor Qisheng Wu has a very good book on like developing with geospatial Python. It talks about that plus a lot of other stuff as well. So it's something definitely to check out. And again, I would leverage AI to do this. AI knows a lot about, you know, pandas and GeoPandas as well. So there's different things you can do to help you pair program, especially if you're just getting started here. That's a great way to go. But again, also if you have a question, try to do it on your own sometimes too. Go to, you know, you can do it the old way, go to Google, look on Stack Overflow. There's lots of information there. So there's lots of different ways to check that out. So let me know, are you using GeoPandas today? Is this something you want to explore? How are you going to use it? And how maybe are you using it to fit in with all the tools you're already using? Let me know in the comments. I'd love to hear more about it. And if you have questions or want to see different tools that I cover in the series, just let me know and I'll definitely start working on those.